E658, lecture 37. Today we will start off on another approach to converting from the analog domain to the digital domain, and this family of converters is called oversampling A-to-D converters. So let me quickly review. First, sampling, I guess all of you know what it is, you should know at this point. So if you have a signal of bandwidth, you know, FB, then you need at least, by Nyquist, you need at least a sampling rate of 2F. Okay. The question is, what happens when you oversample it by a large factor? In other words, let's say the signal bandwidth is FB. So in principle, you need FS needs to be only 2FB. What if FS is some large factor, say OSR times 2FB? Okay. OSR is called the oversampling ratio. Is a key number in all oversampled A-to-D converter work. For argument's sake, what I will do is I will take a sine wave. Okay, FS is 2 hertz. So the Nyquist bandwidth corresponding to this is how much? 1 hertz. Instead of having a sine wave at 1 hertz, I will have F in to be 7 by 1024 times FS. If I sample the sine wave at this frequency at FS, this is a very, very oversampled system. Now I take this sine wave, sample it at FS, and then go through a quantizer. And let me say that the quantizer LSB size is 0.2. The input is a sine wave of amplitude 1. The step size of the quantizer is 0.2. So the output looks like this. So this is time. This red guy here is the quantized output. And the blue chap here is the input. And you can see that the amplitude of the signal is 1 volt. Okay. I mean, see, oversampling is something that we are all used to. So to illustrate that, let me just give you the, show you the quantized output. Okay. And if I told you that this is the output of a quantizer, right, which is sampling a very, very slowly varying signal. If I want you to draw the signal, what will you do? Basically, what you will do is choose some waveform which goes like this, right? So what are you intuitively doing? I mean, you have this jagged waveform with whole bunch of steps, right? And you are getting into the steps and basically drawing a smooth waveform. So what is it? You are basically low pass filter, correct? So this is the basic idea. I mean, you are hoping that this pink chap here is a much better approximation to the input than the step like waveform, right? Straightforward. Now it turns out that, I mean, clearly we all understand that smoothing is nothing but low pass filtering, correct? So this happens to be the spectrum of the quantized input. I mean, from our you know, discussions on quantization noise, what were we expecting? This is FS by 2. Okay, these are all bit numbers on the x axis. So this is FS by 2. So this is 1 hertz. Okay, this is 0. And on the y axis is basically log magnitude of the Fourier coefficients. As you can see, where is the input? Yeah, it should be in the 7th bin, and you know, you can see, I hope you are able to see it, it is that blue thing right next to the y axis here, right. So, that is this chap, okay. And I have normalized the whole thing to that peak so that you will be able to see the, okay. I mean, we assumed in our discussions that quantization noise is what? Uniformly distributed and white, correct. So, if I found the error between the quantized sine wave, okay, and the input sine wave itself, okay, and found the mean square value of that error, that should give you how much? What should be the variance of the error between the input and the quantized output? Delta square by 12, what is delta? 0.2. So, delta square by 12 is how much? 0.04 divided by 12, which is? 1/3, right. So, so it is about 33 into 10 power minus 4, and I actually do the computation, I get 31 into 10 power minus 4, okay. And what we also assumed is that the quantization noise is white, correct. So, in other words, what if that were true, then all these bins would be roughly of the same height. But we know why this thing, I mean, we know it is truly not white. So, we know why all the coefficients do not have the same strength, and you know, all this you know, discussion on SFDR and all this stuff all apply here, okay. So, that explains the spectrum, okay. Now, if I took this and you know, if I want to smooth it, okay, what I can do is pass it through a low pass filter. So, what I did was took this and passed this through a Butterworth low pass filter. All these are digital filters, mind you, we are all talking about, this is nothing but a sample sequence, okay. So, when I say I am taking this sequence and passing it through a Butterworth filter, the Butterworth filter is a digital filter, okay. And with the filter has a cutoff frequency of 0.05 times. So, this is from here to here, what I have done is taken virtually a brick wall Butterworth filter. I mean, I can make a sharper and sharper filter by simply increasing the order of the filter, right. So, without getting into the theory of Butterworth filters, I know that if I put butter, you know, 8, comma, you know, 0.05, MATLAB will give me the coefficients, and then I don't have to worry about it, right. So, this what I did was took the quantized output and passed this through a Butterworth filter of order 8 and a cutoff frequency of 0.05, where 0.05 is normalized to fs by 2, okay. This is the convention in MATLAB, okay. So, I am just using the same thing, correct. So, one corresponds to, this is the band edge relative to fs by 2 or relative to pi, okay. So, the band edge frequency is nothing but 0.05 pi, and I look at the output of the Butterworth filter after steady state has been reached. Compute the spectrum just as I did for this case, and thankfully you see that it lets through stuff around here, okay, and cuts off everything beyond, you know, that frequency 0.05 pi. Spectrum corresponds to a step-like waveform because of quantization. If I go and pass that through a sharp Butterworth filter, what do you expect? You expect a smooth waveform, okay. So, if I took that smooth waveform and subtracted off the smooth waveform also is not simply the input sinusoidal, it is also, it's got some noise. However, the noise component is all confined to the bandwidth of the Butterworth filter, correct. The output of the Butterworth filter is nothing but the input plus a low frequency component of the quantization noise, correct. So, if I subtract off the input with the right phase from the Butterworth filter output, then I should also get an error sequence. You understand?
LPF. This is the quantized input. So the waveform here will be something like this. The waveform here will be something like this. Okay. But this is a real filter. It will have. So this waveform here has got both the sine wave plus low frequency noise, where low frequency noise refers to that within the bandwidth of the Butterworth filter. Correct? So if I want to find the mean square value of the error sequence here, what should I do? I should subtract the sine wave. But what, can I just simply subtract off the input from the output? The Butterworth response will have some phase delay, right? So the input and output will not be, you know, coincident for sure. So how would I account for the phase? What I will do is I will take the input, which is the clean sine wave input, and pass it through the same Butterworth LPF. This should give me a clean sine wave which is lined up with these two. I should get an error sequence. The second one is just a trick to figure, it's just a trick to get rid of the sine wave part so that you only will be able to look at the quantization noise. So what would you expect if I measured the power, the variance of this error here? I would expect it to be much smaller. Why? So looking at it in the frequency domain, you just know that you have just gotten rid of all these bad guys. Right, so you are only left with a little bit of quantization noise. Okay, the so called signal to quantization noise ratio must now be better. And lo and behold, when I do the when I compute the mean square error as I showed you before in the time domain, the mean square error happens to be 1.6 into 10 power minus 4. How much were we expecting? This is 1. Okay, this bandwidth is only 0.05. So if we assume that the quantization noise was white, then how much would we expect? 33 into 10 power minus 4 by 20. And how much is that? 1.6 odd stuff, right? So you can see that you are somewhat close. So it's not exactly 1.65 because, okay, the fact that this is this close itself is mind boggling. Given that everything we have assumed is wrong. Encouraged by our success, the next job is to see, figure out if, you can exploit this principle, right? So, what has oversampling bought us? The signal to quantization noise ratio has increased by a factor of 20, okay? Simply because you oversampled like crazy and gotten rid of the high frequency part of the quantization noise, alright. So the signal to quantization noise ratio is now, has increased by, you know, whatever factor, okay. So you took a lousy quantizer which, whose signal to quantization noise ratio is very bad. You use that to quantize a highly oversampled version of the input signal that you have. This is the reconstruction of the sequence of events. You have taken an input signal, we want to quantize it, you have a lousy quantizer, what do you do? So say, okay, I'm going to do this, I'm going to oversample the input signal like crazy. I know that my signal band is you know, somewhere here, correct? So what I can do is take the output of the quantizer, which in principle based on all our assumptions has got quantization noise which is white. I'll take a digital filter and filter off everything beyond my signal band. So I have gotten rid of a lot of the quantization noise. The signal to quantization noise ratio will be much higher than it was before, equivalently making the lousy quantizer look like a good quantizer. If you were simply to compute the signal to quantization noise ratio of the picture on the right, the signal to quantization noise ratio is smaller than is better by a factor of 20. I mean, if I increase the number of bits by 1, the quantization noise goes down by a factor of, if I reduce the LSB size by a factor of 2, mean square quantization noise will go down by a factor of 4. Here it has gone down by a factor of 20. So now tell me how many bits extra have you got approximately. Okay, I will increase the number of levels by a factor of 2, I will go down by a factor of 4, right? I will increase the number of levels again by a factor of 2, I will go down again by a factor of 4, and 4 times 4 happens to be 16, right? But we have 20, so it's between 2 bits and 3 bits. So if I just gave you the picture on the right and you just measure the signal to quantization noise ratio, you would say actually I have basically not a I divided this into 10 levels, right? So this is basically a 2 volt peak to peak signal has been divided, LSB size is 0.2, so there are 10 levels, right? I have equivalently multiplied the number of levels by a factor 4. Increase of 2 bits is increasing the number of levels by a factor 4. So if I simply measured the signal to noise ratio on the right, it seems as if it could have come from a, you know, from a quantizer with 40 or 45 levels, rather than in reality we have only 10 levels. That makes sense? Okay. But please note that this sequence, it's at a sampling rate fs. Okay. But most of the spectrum is a hole. There is no hole here. There is no signal at all here thanks to the sharp Butterworth filter. So does it now, do you now have to really sample it at you know whatever, at fs, or can I drop samples and still be okay? This is the spectrum of a digital signal which goes from 0 to pi, okay? Alright, and then this repeats somewhere here, right? So what happens when I drop down samples? It will expand, right? So I can go on dropping as many samples until these things basically, what do you call, you know, come together, right? You understand? So what I need to do is the following. So I have this input signal x of t, the continuous time input, with a maximum frequency component fb. If I had a Nyquist rate converter like a flash converter, for example, I would simply be content sampling it at 2fb. But now, no, this is not what I do. What I do is I upsample by a factor, I oversample by some ratio, this is OSR times 2fb, correct? Then what do? I go and put a sharp digital filter. Okay, what must be the corner of the digital filter? In terms of fs and OSR, what must that be? Fs by 2 OSR, okay, alright. Then what should I do? This will just get rid of all the quantization noise beyond the input signal bandwidth. And then what should I do? Once I do that, I can actually drop samples. So if I gave you this inside a black box, input to output will simply be, so what will be the sampling rate at this point? Fs, which is 2fb. Alright, so from input to output, this still looks like a Nyquist rate converter. Okay. So I forgot about the all important quantizer here. I mean, the advantage that we have gained by oversampling is the fact that this poor quality quantizer is now suddenly looking much better than it is. Let us say this is like a 3 bit quantizer, right? So you have 3 digital lines coming out, okay? And you know, all of you are aware of how you realize digital filters, right? What all do you need to realize a digital filter?
Delay,
okay, add and multiply, correct? So if the precision of the input is only 3 bits, can you comment on you know, you're expecting a better performance than the 3 bit quantizer. So let's say you're gaining 2 bits in this whole process, so you're expecting an output bit stream of 5 bit precision. Then what can you comment on the precision required inside the digital filter? should be much higher than 5, because you want the output to be precise to 5 bits, right? So, and whenever you multiply and add and stuff like that, there will be round off errors. So, you know, you will definitely be doing much better if you have a large number of bits inside the digital filter. But, I mean, one thing is for sure that the internal precision should be at least 5 bits, or definitely better than 5 bits. You understand? So, this digital filter has a lot of digital, I mean, has a lot of logic inside. Okay? So, you are basically trading off analog complexity for digital complexity. The number of transistors in the digital filter will be huge. Okay? But the effort needed to synthesize a digital filter is, you know, with today's CAD tools is, because the guy who designed the CAD tool has done all the thinking for you, right? So, you can do, so you can get away by, you know, just writing some code and not even knowing what a transistor is, and you get a full filter out. So, you are putting all the complex signal processing and, you know, all in the digital domain, and in digital everything is nice. So, you know, there is, no, the multiply coefficients are what you think they are and all this other stuff, right? So, unless you screw up, you know, you can't have it not work. The things like this become attractive when it becomes easier and easier to do, easier and cheaper and faster to do digital post-processing, massive amounts of it, okay, and when it becomes more and more difficult to do the analog, which is the quantizer. So basically you can see that if I oversample by a factor of 2x, how much improvement in SQNR do I get? OSR is 2. It is 3 dB. Alright. So, to get like say 4 bit improvement in signal to noise quantization oscillation, in other words, to make a 4 bit quantizer look like an 8 bit quantizer, what do you think I should, what should the oversampling ratio be? This is half a bit for 2x OSR, alright. So, if I want a 4 bit improvement, I will need 2 to the power, 4 bits is 8, right, so it is 2 to the power 8, okay, which is, so the, I need an oversampling ratio of 256 to make a 4 bit quantizer look like an 8 bit quantizer by simply oversampling. Alright. And please note that this all is based on the, you know, our spectral interpretation of quantization noise. Okay. So, can you give me a class of signals for this? This doesn't work at all. What is the simplest example you think for which this whole thing breaks? You put DC, right? You oversample by anything, the quantization error is constant. You can't get rid of it at all. You understand? So, you know, clearly you can think of cases for which it doesn't work. If the quantization errors key, I mean, you know, remains the same all the time, then you are screwed, okay? And quantization error will remain the same when the input remains absolutely static. Correct? So, what conditions must you put on the input? You must make sure that the input kind of varies, okay? So, this is as scientific as it can get. So, such signals are called busy signals, okay? So, you will see this a lot in sigma delta work. And this whole digital engine here, which consists of a very, very good sharp low pass filter, as well as the, you know, dropping samples part, is called the decimation filter. From a signal processing viewpoint, just dropping samples is called decimation, right? But in sigma delta parlance, it consists of this whole engine, which is basically the sharp digital filter, and then dropping samples is trivial, right? You just, you know, clock the output at a lower clock rate. That's implementation wise, that's trivial. The digital filter is the one which takes you know, a lot of effort. Okay. And there are a whole bunch of you know, architectural techniques which can be used to reduce power dissipation inside the digital filter itself. That obviously I'm not going to go into this in this course, right? For the time being, you just assume that you have available an ideal brick wall type digital low pass filter, which goes and cuts off all the stuff which is out of band, right? So the so this is called the, and everything outside the signal bandwidth is by fairly logical, you call it all the out of band signals, correct? And you know, so the bottom line is that you get half a bit improvement by increasing the oversampling, for a 2x increase in OSR. Okay, so for again, to get some more time domain intuition, this blue thing here is the quantization noise when I take the difference between the input clean sine wave and the quantized output. This on the other hand, so this is y minus yq, alright, and this is nothing but y filtered minus y quantized and filtered, the red guy. Couple of things are evident from this picture. The frequency content of the red guy is much smaller than that of the blue guy, right? Because the blue chap is, you know, jumping up and down all the time, whereas the red one is lot more controlled, okay? And clearly the amplitude of the red waveform is much smaller than the amplitude of the blue waveform. I mean, the red waveform is nothing but, you know, the blue waveform gone and filtered by a Butterworth filter, but a sharp Butterworth low pass filter, okay? So if I just gave you the red waveform and told you and asked you what the cutoff frequency of the filter was, will you be able to tell me? Yeah. So I'm telling you that I've taken white noise and passed it through a ideal brick wall filter, whatever this, you can approximate it to be an ideal brick wall, correct? So now can you tell me what the question is, can you tell me what the brick wall cutoff is by looking at the this guy here? No, of course, clearly if I took a Fourier transform of the red waveform and look at it, then it's apparent, right? At least that should be apparent. You understand? Okay. Now let's try and build some time domain intuition. You should have it, right? I mean, it's doing the math and, you know, computing HOJM and all is all fine, but look at the waveform, you should definitely be able to figure out what the cutoff frequency is. I mean, now you know the answer, but you should be able to correlate it with some feature of this waveform. Yes, that's correct. But how does that help you figure out what the cutoff frequency of the Butterworth is? You have only one number to estimate. The only thing you can make out from this waveform is these things, right? So if anything, the time period of these seemingly periodic stuff, right, must be related somehow to the cutoff frequency of the filter, right? The question is, how is it related? What is the approximate time period? The period of the waveform, this is in seconds, okay? The x-axis is in seconds, okay? The sampling rate is, so what is the period of the waveform? I don't know, maybe just, yeah, it is actually around 20, right? Because it's definitely this peak is beyond 25 seconds is 0.04 hertz, right? The Butterworth is 0.05 hertz. It's 0.05 times fs by 2, which is fs is 2 hertz, right? So this is 0.05 times. So looking at the waveform, you know that the cutoff frequency of the Butterworth is about 0.04 hertz, right? That's what the estimate is telling you. But why is this correct? So you don't know anything about digital filters. Let's see, if you have an analog filter with a band edge at f0, what does it mean? Highest frequency component in the impulse response is at f0, correct? Yes. So whenever you see a sharp cutoff, what does it mean? If you see a sharp cutoff in a HFF magnitude plot, can you comment on location of at least one set of poles? So if you take any filter, right, which has got a sharp cutoff at some frequency f naught, okay, with my eyes closed, I'll tell you that there are probably two poles at some very small sigma and some j omega naught, which is approximately f naught. Correct? Why? Why does this make sense? See, when do you get the sharp magnitude cutoff? Only when the q is high. Correct? Okay. So if something is falling off rapidly at f naught, that must be coming in the transfer function. Please note that the transfer function, even if there are a billion poles, right, the transfer function is the stuff that you get when you keep traveling along the j omega axis and keep going up, right, and you at every point you keep drawing these distances and then computing, you know, 1 over p1, p2, p3, all the stuff that you did in networks and systems, okay. So for which of these poles is the change in the magnitude the largest? It's for the,
for this pole is the, for the high Q pole is when the magnitude will vary as you go from here to here. It is, here it is very large, here it is very small. So the change in the magnitude is the largest for this pole. Correct? So taking, turning the whole argument upside down, if you find that there is a big change in the magnitude response, that must be coming from a bunch of poles, at least two poles, I mean one here and one here, with high Q. Correct? Okay. Now that you have figured that out, if you have high Q, what can you say about the impulse response? So it will continue for the longest time. If you have the highest Q pole pair is here, all these are much lower Qs, that means these things will decay much quicker. So the stuff that remains, if you whack the filter with a step or an impulse, the stuff that remains after a long time is simply is a sinusoid which is getting, you know, which is going down, which is getting damped slowly, but the frequency will be of about f naught. Does this make sense? Okay. Now if I took this filter and bombarded it with white noise, which white noise basically you keep the filter input any old way you want. That's what it means. Correct? Okay. And high Q basically of these pole pairs means the filter tends to remember only frequency components around f. So what remains is the output of the filter is simply stuff at sinusoids of various random amplitudes getting added together. Okay. All where they're all decaying, but the zero crossing time is what f naught. So if you look at the output, you will definitely see. Okay? The same thing applies to a bandpass filter. If you had a narrow bandpass filter centered around f naught, what does it mean? You have all, if you have a bandpass filter with you have two transitions at f naught, right? One just below, before f naught the magnitude goes up. Just after f naught, the magnitude comes down. So there it must be. You must be at least have two poles there, right? Which basically makes it even more selective. You will see a strong, if you look at, you could drive a bandpass filter with a noise output, with some noisy waveform, the output will virtually look like a sine wave at that center frequency. Only its amplitude and phase will be varying randomly. That's what, you know, these are all what are called narrow band processes. That's what you have seen in, you know. So narrow band waveform is something which is centered around the sea and then is a very small bandwidth, so that appears as random amplitude and phase modulation, okay, which is going on at a rate much lower than the center frequency. Okay, so that is the intuition behind why the waveform here looks like this. Does this make sense? Okay. Oversampling seems like definitely a reasonable idea by which you take a poor quantizer and make it look like a better one, right? But unfortunately the gains seem to be, I mean half a bit per 2x increase in OSR is good definitely, but the question now is it possible to do better? I mean if you can do better, many possibilities open up. One,
you can make a 4 bit quantizer look like a 16 bit quantizer, right? Okay, and now you get even more greedy and say I will make a 1 bit quantizer look like a 16 bit quantizer, okay. So people have not become so greedy as to say there is no quantizer and it will still look like a. So that is the, at least the motivation for looking at, you know, you have oversampled stuff, but maybe you can do something better, okay. So far we have seen, we have some quantizer, at least we think that it can be modeled by some quantization noise E of n, alright. But one thing we have to understand is the following, that is, what is the simplest quantizer you made? We have made a flash quantizer, right? You take the input, compare it with a whole bunch of references and get this. So if a particular sample is being quantized, right, when is the quantized output available? I mean, in real time it is available a small delay after the sampling instant, okay. But if your whole notion of time is only ticks of a clock, okay, then it is only available at the next instant. Great. So our model for the quantizer is basically not just some process which adds quantization error, but also a simple delay. Alright. Now let us see. If you have some box which is giving you error, right? So you have input, you think you are getting input plus error. Okay, you don't want the error, right? So what is the simplest thing you can, what is, I mean, conventionally what are you used to, if the output is misbehaving with respect to the input, what do you need? I mean, one way of attempting to do this is to compare the time tested trick of going and kicking the, making sure the fellow doesn't misbehave by comparing the output with the input and kicking the, this guy here, right? So who is misbehaving? So if, I mean, so based on our prior knowledge, if this gain was infinity, or this, let's say this gain was A, then hopefully the input and the output will remain the same. Now let's see if that really works based on the fact that this is a sample data system and the quantizer is actually modeled as Z inverse X of n. So let's see, call this V of n. Does it sound reasonable? Right? All that I have done is replace, so this is the quantizer. Correct? And you know, as a simpleton, I would say, oh, if the gain of the op amp of the amplifier becomes infinite, the output must be equal to the, yeah. So let's see, we can do the math and figure out if this works. So typically in all this, in these examples, right, in the literature, the input to the quantizer is denoted by Y and the quantizer output is denoted by V, okay. And a good way of remembering this stuff is that Y is the input, something has gotten chopped off, right, and you get V, so you get the output, okay. So this is a mnemonic I use to remember which Y is and which V is, okay. All right. So now let's do the math. So the nice thing is you do go and get into the Z domain. So X of Z minus V of Z, Z inverse V of Z times A plus E of z must be equal to E of z. Okay. I mean, thanks to our additive quantization noise approximation, it now looks like there are two independent inputs into the into this linear system. I mean, we can do it one at a time. All right. So, the output V of z due to x of z can be calculated in the following fashion. You set E of z to be 0. So, x of z must be equal to A z inverse plus 1 times, which basically means that V of z by x of z is 1 by A z inverse plus A x of z must be equal to A z inverse. Where is the pole? Oh, what is the order of the system? First order. Very good. Where is the pole? Minus A. Okay. And ideally, what did we want A to be? We want A to be infinity. And so, unfortunately, in a discrete time system, all the poles better stick to within the unit circle. So, if you put make A very, very large, what happens? The pole is here. So, it is, okay, it is not just, so the system is not just crazy, okay, it is a raving lunatic, okay, alright, you understand. So, clearly this does not work, okay. I mean, and the reason is kind of apparent. I mean, time domain wise, if you simply think of this system, if the output is not equal to the input, the correction is actually large and negative, okay, alright, and that keeps circulating and the geometric progression goes on blowing up, right. So, let us say V of n was 0 initially, A was say 100, okay, x was 1. So, what happens? The error becomes 1 minus 0 times 100, which is 100. So, the output goes to 100. And then what does the thing realize? The realizes the error is 100, but is in the opposite direction. So, it goes to minus 10,000. Then it realizes that the error is 10,000 in the wrong direction. So, it goes up and, you know, this keeps going. Bottom line, there is too much delay in the feedback loop. Please note that if it worked, this would be just fantastic, because the output volt, I mean, if A was infinite and this was actually working stably, then the output to the input will remain the same. So, there is no error. So, in other words, the error would have just gotten, you know, gotten rid of completely, okay, making the lousy quantizer look like a like an ideal, I mean, like with an infinitely precise quantizer. So, clearly there must be, clearly this does not work. We have to figure out if it is, you know, we have to figure something else out maybe. So, perhaps it is not just enough to have gain, okay, a flat gain. Maybe you have to do something to this to make it actually stable. I mean, finally want, we first want the loop to be stable, then you can figure out how much you are gaining, correct?